All right, all right, all right. Welcome back to the channel. How's everybody doing out there? Hope everybody is well. So tonight we're going to talk about the monad. We have some esoteric teachings in the Holy Megillah Nazarene Bible of the Essene Way from Yahshua. And he talks about monads as points of view in spiritual evolution. So it's going to be a little different teaching, you know that. Yeshua put an S on the end of this, monads. And so we got a couple of places in the Megillah we can jump over to the Nazarene Emerald Tablets and hear a little sacred geometry on the monad. We'll do that at the end if we have time. And we're also going to jump over to this other website because, listen at this, the term monad is from ancient Greek, monas, unity, and monos, alone. So this symbol means unity and alone. It is used in some cosmic philosophy and cosmology to refer to a most basic or original substance. As originally conceived by the Pythagoreans, the monad is the supreme being, divinity, or the totality of all things. Now, in the Nazarene Emerald Tablets, it tells us that Pythagoras studied with Nasareans early on in his life. So these teachings, it says it was conceived by the Pythagoreans. Wait until you hear it, and then you'll be able to tell whether it's original or not, okay? But in India, they have this teaching too, where this unity and alone type of thing where we have to grasp. I looked up this website. I love this, Om equals MC square. You see that? This is a science and non-duality website. This is so fresh. Remember that part of the Megillah where it says preserve in the water until it becomes a mirror? Yeah, it's talking about compassion. And when you have compassion for your fellow creatures in this world, it will become a mirror. You will understand that everything is self. How can everything be self and yet at the same time there be no self? And so that's the same thing this symbol is saying, right? It's telling us that it means unity and alone, right? So this is the same concept. So just keep all of this in mind while we're reading, because until you hear what Yeshua has to say, it might be a little confusing about how everything could be self and at the same time there could be no self. So it also says that the monad is frequently described as a divine spark, which is an appropriate expression, for it is a part of the logos, the divine fire. And the monad is a term used in sacred geometry that represents the primary principle that governs the mind as the electromagnetic energy field that surrounds, informs, and animates all living matter. Something that keeps coming to my mind as I was doing this study on this was the term we have for monotheism and polytheism. And I'm thinking that it's kind of like the same thing, because mono means one, right? And poly means many. And this is it too, unity and one. Out of one comes many. You know, that's what Yeshua is going to show us, that the monads are all points of view for the monad. And get this reading going. Okay, this is chapter 81, Esoteric Teachings on Monads as Points of View in Spiritual Evolution. And this starts in verse 97, the Holy Megillah Nazarene Bible of the Essene Way. So it says, one of the 12 guests that had attended the sermon near Jerusalem was so wise and sincere that the Lord invited him to stay the night with the companions after the other 11 departed home to Jerusalem. After those 11 departed, Yahshua told this man and the companions, we should not sleep here. The wind is blowing us elsewhere. We will stay tonight, not in a fox den, but in a lion's den. So they led the group to a farmhouse that was maintained by a Nasarean line of Zayin. And after some herbal tea and dinner, the sincere wise man from Jerusalem revealed what Yahshua already recognized, that he was not an Aaronite Jew, but he was a Jewish convert to Greek philosophy, particularly the philosophy of Pythagoras. So after some general conversation, The philosopher encouraged Yeshua to speak on the topic of monads. The philosopher said to Yeshua, "Wise one, your teachings are similar to the Pythagoreans. You similarly use the word monad. I have studied that topic for years, but I intuit this night you will reveal something about monads that I have not yet considered." So verse 111, Yeshua said, "In sacred geometry, as you know, the monad is often symbolized as a point. Each point is a oneness that is a part of the all-inclusive oneness that consists of all points. That all-inclusive monad is called the universal one. But few philosophers, even amongst the wise Pythagoreans, realize that each point, each monad, each soul is literally a point of view. We are all points of view, and we each have a particular perspective. The universal one can simultaneously see through the eyes of every point of view, and every point of view has the freedom to change its perspective according to its own self-development in spiritual evolution." Listen, the amazing thing is that the universal one gets to experience and thus learn from every point of view imaginable simultaneously, and also throughout eternal duration, even as each point of view evolves and thus changes its perspective many times. As each point evolves by stepping into actuality as a line, each point then manifests its own world line, its own eternally unfolding personal history. And each line, even as it evolves throughout duration and changes its perspective, always is a point of view that is itself being viewed by the universal one. We're at verse 119. The universal one then has all access to everything ever viewed by any point of view, along with every consideration ever considered by those points, and also has access to all of the insights and lessons that will continue to be had as each point of view evolves and thus changes perspectives numerous times throughout eternal duration. The universal monad has such an unfathomable body of knowledge and wisdom that it is not possible for any individual monad to accurately imagine just how much that actually totals. And even that unimaginable total is constantly increasing as each individual monad keeps learning, keeps evolving, keeps contributing everything it views to the ever-expanding universal intelligence. Even the universal monad continues to evolve as it continues to receive and process the lessons of every evolving individual point of view. It said the eternal journey of any particular individual point, individual monad, is that point's personal world line. Each individual world line in motion through the universe is actually a life spiral. One life spiral of countless life spirals on the spiral ladder of spiritual evolution. While the universal monad receives the insights of every individual point of view and thus gains knowledge and wisdom from that relationship, so can each individual point gain knowledge and wisdom from its relationship with the universal monad. That incredible storehouse of knowledge and wisdom within the universal monad can be accessed by the individual monad to the degree that is appropriate at any particular stage of spiritual evolution. That is the great universal intelligence, the divine mind, that we each have sensed and sometimes intentionally have accessed. Even when we are not intentionally accessing it, we benefit from that relationship because it is within us and all around us all the time, influencing us via intuition and in truth by every lesson that life presents to us, informing our own evolution by including us in the one universal evolution. Perceiving that Yeshua had finished speaking, the philosopher said, "Indeed, you have given me new insights into insight. And my new insight on the nature of the individual monad is I now see, being seen by the universal monad, that one that sees all through all from every perspective, even as those perspectives continue to evolve. Amazing. It says, after a pause in which everyone in the room was deeply silent, Tom spoke for us all when he said, wow. Still like, wow, because each time you read it, it will get deeper, it will get deeper, it will help you to understand. Let's jump over and hear what Abraham, the Abram, said about it real quick in the Nazarene Emerald Tablets, chapter 63, verse 66. He says, diversity within unity is apparent upon deep contemplation. And then he said, unity in diversity is equally apparent. Yeah, y'all might want to go back and listen to this again, but I'll do some more videos on it so we'll have a deeper and a little more lengthy study on it. All right, guys, stay tuned. I'll be back. Each monad is a part of larger bodies made up of other monads. Each monad participating in the one universal monad that includes all. Each monad also simultaneously experiencing being an individual soul, a self within the universal self. Since each part of the inclusive all has the same sense of individuality as does the first one. After all, we are all extensions from that one. Wherefore I say, as above, so below.